Welcome to this session about code versioning with Git, which will be delivered by Olivier Matelas from UC Louvain. The floor is yours.
Yeah, thanks, Damien. I just realized that I forget to put my slides on Indigo, so I will do that during the first break, so sorry for that. But when we arrive at the first break and in the first time to do exercise, at that time I will put the slides. So I first have to thank actually a couple of people because I've shared, I've taken a lot of their material actually, because they were given kind of the same tutorial sessions before. So we've partnered Damien, Juan, and Jonathan from the CC. And then also I've taken a lot of material from Scott Shalcon, this Git author that I don't know him personally, but I found this material online and use it. So, there are basically four parts to these lectures. The first one is historical perspective. So explain you a bit what code versioning is, explaining you the different code existing for code versioning. Not that much, I would say, that you have to learn. It's mainly for general knowledge so that you know a bit what are the different code, which one is the most popular, which one is the less popular. And after that, we'll only focus on the most popular one, which is Git. And then we will cover first mainly the basics. So what is the revisions, what is the versions, how to track files, I mean all the very basic stuff. Then we'll move to what I call workflow, the possibility with multiple revisions of your own code, one for development, one for release, one for having a feature versions and so on and so on. And that's what they call branching workflow. And then at the end, we'll see a bit how to go online so that with collaborations with collaborators, obviously, and then how to use GitHub and GitLab and similar tools. So let's start. And the first idea is quite trivial, obviously, is what is code versioning? So code versioning is in itself something that I guess you have all done, and I'm still doing that sometimes, actually, even if it's a bit stupid. You take basically a file, and at some point when you have edited and you think, oh, that's a good status, I want to be able to go back to it. So on top of having a backup where you know that we have all those backups, you want to have an easy way to go back to a version of the file, and then you start changing its name and saying, okay, this version is 2 and then this version is 2 with corrections, and you update that file, and then you have a collection of file, which is the same file, but which evolved with time. You have a history of all the modifications of your file. And that's something that I'm pretty sure you have all done for papers, you have all done for your thesis, and you are also sometimes doing that for code. And that is really the idea of, I want to be able to go back in time to be sure that this version is working, I want to be able to go back there if something is going on. So that is mainly the main goal of code versioning, and I actually add two other goals that I think which are quite important for code versioning. So instead of this history of modifications, there's also, I think, something important, teamwork and workflow. Let me focus a bit more first on this first goal, history of modification. So I already said it's really important with this possibility to go back in time. So for book or paper thesis, it's a bit less important up to some extent, but for code, I think it's very crucial. Because then it's allow you to say, oh, how was that file a year from now? And that's especially important when you have a bug. I mean, in my life as a developer, I sometimes found a bug. When I see the bug report, I have zero clue what's going on. The only thing I know is that 5 years from now, it was working, and today it's not working. I have no clue when during that 5 years period, these bugs appear. And from the bug itself, I have no clue where in this 100,000 line of code I have to pinpoint what is going on. So in that case, the only way for me to find what's going on is to be able to track, to go back in time, to take the same version of the code, but now 2 years from now, run the code, see if it's working or not. And then like that, find what versions create that mistakes. And then it's really crucial for me to have those three informations here. So who did that change? Is it me responsible, or it's one of my colleagues? It's one of my colleagues interesting to go in contact with him to double check some stuff. When it's done, that's simple obviously, but also why that developer or myself changed that code? Was it for bug fixing? That means if I just revert it, that means now the previous bug is still is back again. Or was it for a feature revision, I mean a new features? I need then to check that this feature is still working and so on and so on. So that's information, this why, is something that will not be able to be done automatically. Who is doing it and when? That's trivial. We know who is typing the command. We know the time of when that command is done. But the why is something that you will need to provide, and we'll see that later. That's a crucial information that is not automatic that we need to provide, saying why I have changed all those stuff. So that's for the first part, history of modifications. The second part, which is for me quite important, is it's a teamwork. When you are developing a code or paper, you are not working alone, you are working with collaborators. And it's quite important that you are able to work, all of you, at the same time. So I'm always referring to this, what I call Dropbox organizations, which is used quite often by some of my collaborators for writing paper. So they put everything on Dropbox, and then they start to modify. But in Dropbox, if you have multiple people modifying the same file at the same time, it doesn't work very well. You have some conflict file, but you have no clue how to resolve those conflicts. And therefore, the typical way solutions of people is to send an email to everyone saying, oh, I'm working on that file now. Please don't touch that file for the next couple of hours. So that is something that basically in Dropbox, you are blocking your setting. Only one person is working at a time. And that's, of course, very bad. So I think for teamwork, it's important that everyone can work at the same time. And the second feature, which I think is important, is that it can be asynchronous. It can be nice if you go in a plane that you can work in your plane without any internet connections. Or if you go somewhere without internet connections, you are able to work completely offline. So that's, there are some ways to work completely online. To take Google Doc, for example, then everyone is working at the same time and you see what the others are doing in real time. And that's basically prevents you to both people editing the same line at the same time. That's very useful, that's very nice. Overleaf is doing that for paper, and that's wonderful, obviously, as well. But I think it's, especially for code, it's important that you can be not all everyone on the same file at the same time, but you can work in your plane without internet connections. And that, of course, requires the fact that two people can work on the same file at the same time, and then even if you don't know if they are working because you don't have live communication between everyone working, you need to have conflict resolutions, and we'll see that later. How do you handle the fact that two people modify the same line basically at the same time, and but provide two different solutions at the end, or how to fix maybe the same problem? And finally, the third goal, it's the third goal of code versioning is what I call workflow. It's really important, mainly for code in this case, to be able to test new ideas. Oh, I have one wonderful idea to change that part of the code. I have no clue if it's going to work or not. It needs to be really easy to modify a part of the code without screwing up everything else and screwing up all the other people who are working on the same code. So having the possibility to have a separate development is really quite important. And also, if we have a relatively large code, not even that large actually, you typically will add multiple versions of your code. You will add a stable version, that's the one that everyone is supposed to use. And then you will add a couple of development versions, like a debug version, where you only change some small bug fixing. Or a couple of feature versions that will be released later, typically as a second digit in your versioning, which include new ID, and maybe also some big release that break backward compatibility API, and then it's typically a big release. So typically you are not working on one at a time, you're working on a couple of features, couple of the debugging you basically work each time there is a bug report, obviously. And you have all those versions. It's important that you are able to pass the features from one to the other, and typically the bugs you want to have them fixed also in all those feature releases. So you typically have multiple versions. It's quite important that you have an easy way to pass web modifications from one of those branch, those versions, to another. So those are the big goals of code versioning. So there are a couple of codes we are able to do that. And here is you have the website here, which is tracking how much, those codes are popular. So this is from 2017. This is the repartition from 2019, which is basically the same now. This is a stabilized. So in 2020, it's basically the same pictures up to 2%. Actually. So it didn't change too much anymore. well, in the last, I mean, from 2017 to 2019, that changed actually quite a lot. So the big part, which is already in 2017, but even more now, is Git. So that's really now close to 72% actually in 2020. So it's really the big part. That's why we are going to focus on that one. Subversion is actually quite old. It's still quite popular. Now it's actually 23%. But okay, that's shrinking, but relatively slowly now. And then there is three other codes, CVS, which is extremely old, and you certainly should not start anything with CVS, and you should not use CVS at all. And then my favorite, which is Bazaar, and you know Damien, the Damien favorite, which is actually Mercurial, which are both 1%. Actually, Bazaar now, in the latest 2020, even works 0%. So it's a bit not that great. So I will not encourage you to use neither Mercurial nor Bazaar, actually. Even they are really great, actually, both of them. So what is the big difference between all those codes? And there are two types of difference. The first one, which doesn't really matter for you, is the type of storage that they use. So let's assume you have a version, you have a file, which is first in version one, and then you change it in version two. What is going to be stored in your disk, your hardware, in case of delta storage, that will be the first versions of the file, and then the difference between the two files. In the case of DAC storage, it will be actually the two files. So you keep all information, all the files completely, and you basically hope that the tiring of everything that will basically not take too much place. So that's the first difference, and that's really a difference that doesn't matter really for you. It has, of course, some performance implications, but at the end of the day, it doesn't matter that much. The second difference is a bit more crucial, is the type of communications. So there are three levels here. Local, that means everything is local to a computer, that means everyone's need to go on that computer and everything is local to a given computer. So that's very old style and not used anymore at all. We have centralized, which is a central server, and you need always everything's go to that single central server, and that's where you find SVN. So SVN is subversion. So that's one quite popular one. And the latest one is actually the same as Git, which is distributed, and there you, where each versions of the code has all the information. So there is no one central source of truth, like in the centralized versions. All versions have the full information, they can become the next source of truth. So typically, people synchronize themselves in a single place, but there is nothing particular on that place compared to what is on your laptop, or what is the laptop of your colleague, or what is online on GitHub. All those versions contain the same information, technically. And also in distributed, you find Git, which is here as a DAC storage, and also Bazaar, which is here in DAC storage as well. And that's why I would say Git, Bazaar, and Mercurial are very nice because they are really at the top level. Distributed is really a must-have, I would say, those days. Centralized is at the end. I mean, I use CVS quite a lot, SVN a bit, and they are always a bit annoying because of that and not very portable when you need to move from one place to the other. So I really don't encourage you at all to use centralized version those days. SVN is still used quite a lot, but if you can avoid it, it's better. Okay, so now we are going to move a bit from this history level and enter a bit more in details of really what is Git and all the key concepts of Git. So let's start by the history, and after I will move to what is called the three phases of Git. It's basically, where you are working and all the data, where the data is stored. That's a crucial concept to understand. So first, commits. So what is an history? An history is a succession of snapshots of your files and key time of the development. So that you decide at some point, you say, okay, now let's do a snapshot. Let's freeze all my files and so that I can keep the status of all my files at that given time. And in the context of code versioning, those snapshots are simply called commits. That's the technical term commits. And more exactly what a commit contains, it contains all your files at that given time. They have a unique name. I mean, in Git, that's a quasi unique name, which is hash technically. In this context, I will just call them C and then a number, C1, C2, C3, so that we have also an idea of succession between those commits. And then it contains a couple of metadata that we represent here, like here this picture saying who created the file. I didn't put a date, but that also information, so when the file was created, and some information about why you create that commit at a given time. What did you change in your code? I said that in the beginning, that's a crucial information, which is important for you, for yourself 5 years from now, but also for your collaborators to know what you changed and why you changed that. And then also a commit is a pointer to the previous commit. So the commit itself contains the full history. So you know that is the status of all my times now, and before it was that, and before that it was that, and before that it was that, and go and so on and so on. So you have actually the full history information with a simple commit. So let's make that a bit more clear. Maybe I will go very slow for some of you. Let's start by your first commit. So I know that me has done it. We have a couple of files, and I'm explicit here two files, file one, which is for the one in version one, and file two, which is also in version one. Then I'm going to modify one file and then create a new commit. So now I call this commit as this name is commit two, and that's this file now it's version two, and this file is still the same. I can continue and now decide, okay, my file two now is useless, so let's remove it, do again a commit, and then file one version two. I'm not forced to only modify one file at a time, but that just to give you the idea that you are doing something which makes sense, which is adding a new features, fixing a bug, and that, of course, can go multiple files. Then when you are happy with your status, you think it's important to save it, it has some logic, then you commit, you put a message and saying, okay, I changed that to fix that bug, I changed that to do this, I changed that to do that, and then you create this new commit. So of course, this is a quite heavy representation. So in practice, I'm going to simplify the representation and always represent a commit by simply a square box with its name C1, C2, C3, and an arrow that describes the history of all my commits. That's a simplified representation. And because for all the tools that I'm going, for all this talk, I don't care what file I change, I don't care if I'm removing file, adding file, editing file, and so on and so on. The only thing which is important is the logic that, okay, I modified something from this commit to this commit to this commit. Okay, so that's the first concept, what a commit is, and that contains files, information, a name, and also a link to the previous commit. The next concept, which is crucial for Git, is this three area of Git. So a lot of people, even a lot of people that are using Git, I would say quite often, don't understand that concept. They think that there are actually only two areas where there are three, and that can be completely confusing then when they are using those the Git command, because sometimes there are modifications related to the index, and if they don't know the index exists, they can be completely screwed and don't understand what's going on. So it's really crucial that you know that those three areas exist. The index area in particular is not used that much, but it's important that you know that it exists, and you know that sometimes, and especially when you read the help, they will say, oh, I'm putting that in the index, that you know that this place exists. So let me explain those three areas. The first area is the simplest one, it's the workspace. So it's the place in your computer where you have all your files, when you can see them with ls, you can open them, edit them, you can modify them, obviously. So that's really the place where you are working, editing the file, changing file, editing, creating new features, and doing good stuff. That's the simple place. That's where really you are working every day, and that's where you are productive. The second place, which is quite here as well, is what I call the repository. So this is where you store all the data. And that's where you store actually all the commits, all those files. You see in Git, it's not storing delta functions within the files, it's really storing a lot of files. So that's where all the files will be put, all the information will be, and that's where, if you have an issue, that's where you are going to take all the information, obviously. So in practice, it's inside your working directory. It's a .git it, and you can look inside. There's not that much to look at because everything is binary, obviously. But that's where all information is stored. The third place is the index. And you can see the index as a staging area. So when you have a file, and what you need to put in the repository is actually not a file, but it's a box. So the index place is really where you are preparing your file inside a box. And when your box is ready, then you put that box inside your repository. So in the normal way to work, you're working in your workspace, you're editing files. Then when your files is ready, you put it inside the box. Then you can continue to modify other files or even the same files. And when they are ready, you put them in the box. And then when you think, okay, my box is what I call a commit, is fully ready, then you move that box here to the storage place, to the repository, and then you will add basically a commit here in this list. And that is the workflow in Git. It's really those three areas. You work in your workspace, you move everything inside the box, in the index, and then when the box, you seal it and you put inside the repository. And the index is technically storing .git index. Okay. So let's take an example. So I'm starting here with two files, A and B, and I'm starting from what I call, say, a clean state. That means my file A and B is the same in the workspace, in the index, in the repository. So I just same copy everywhere. So everything is nice, and that's a good starting point. Then, of course, my point is to modify files. I still want to work, obviously. So I'm opening my file A with my favorite text editor, modifying the code, for example, adding a line. And here for the representations, what I did, I changed this color. But you say it's not the same file anymore, it's now it's red. So now you will have a first command to move that file inside the index. And that is git add A. So that's saying literally puts A inside the box. And that's moving then, copying the file A from the workspace inside the index. And you see now inside my index, my file is red. And now I can choose to continue to modify A, I can modify B, put them in the box if I want a new version of A, I can decide. Or when I'm ready, I make everything ready inside my index, I can move my index inside a repository, and that is git commit minus M. And then here you put the message. I always say it's important that you know why you make modifications, and that's here that you have to specify what did you do. In this case, I changed color because that represents what I've done on the slide. But it's really important that this commit is a message which is meaningful. So when I mean meaningful, it's not like update, change, or something like that. Because for 5 years from now, if you see what did you do on update, it's not very useful for yourself, obviously. It's your choice, obviously, to do that or not. It's your choice and responsibility to put something meaningful so that for you, in a couple of years, you know what you did, and it's clear for you that, yeah, that can be a commit which is interesting to look at because it's maybe related to one of my bugs that I have today. Okay, and then you can continue and do the same. So typically, when there's two steps here. You first, you take your file, you put it inside the index, and then from the index, you move it to the repository. So there's two commands, therefore, you have git add and then git commit. In Git, you always have a way to combine two commands to a single one. So in this case, it's very useful. So I'm putting it. If you have git commit minus A minus M, and then you put your message again, that's allow you to automatically, yes, good, to automatically add, that's what the minus A is doing, ultimately add all the files that were known, and you put in the index, and then automatically put the index into the repository. So that's allow you with git commit minus A to pack together two commands, git add and git commit. Okay, so I think it's time for a small demonstration. So let's do that. What do I do? Yeah, I will go to my created directory. Let's create a directory. Let's go inside. Okay. So for that, there is nothing inside my directory, and I will do git init, and that will initialize my directory so that it's ready for git. Basically, what it did is it creates this .git directory. So do ls, you don't see anything. Of course, if I do ls minus a, you will see something. Okay, now I can create a first file. We call it hello. And inside I will write something stupid. Okay, so what I can do is to add this file, or maybe first I can show you a first useful command, which is git status. And it tells me a lot of information. So for the moment, I don't have any commits. I just started, it's normal. And I have what it's called untracked file. So it realized that there's a file in my directory, which is called hello. But for the moment, it doesn't know it. So it doesn't follow. If I change it, it doesn't know about it. I mean, basically, that's a file that's just there. And you will have sometimes file that you don't want to track. If you want to start to track it, it's the same command as if you were tracking it already. It's also git add. So in this case, for the first time, git commit minus am will not take on this file because it doesn't track it yet. So in that case, I need really to do git add. So now if I'm going back to git status, it say, oh, I now have this file hello, and the change are ready to be committed. So now I can do git commit minus m first hello world. And now I can do git status. And it say, okay, now I'm in the perfect state, no, tree clean, so I'm clean. That means I have the same file in my workspace, in my index, and in my repo. So now I have this hello everywhere. So I can now change this file again. And I will say, hello, Frederick. This is following us. So now I can do git status again to check what is the status. You will say change not state for commit. So that means he realized that this file hello was modified, but it's not yet in my index. So then it tells me what I can do. I can do git add or git commit minus a. So let me do git commit minus a. If I don't provide a minus m in the message like I do here, it will open a text editor. Most of your case will probably be VI. In my case, I configure it to be Emacs, and then I can put my message. Do something pass to Frederick. Sorry, Frederick. So now what you can look at is git log. So in git log, you will see there are two commits. You see those very long names that represent the name of my commit. My author, the author, I've configured, of course, git before with my name. So it's know that it's me who have done it. The time, of course, automatic, and each time the message, first hello world and pass to Frederick. One very convenient option for git log is minus minus one line. That's give a shorter name, which is typically unique to the version, and then you still have most of the information. And for later, I will specify it here. I will quite often use git log minus minus one line minus minus graph, which allow you additional features, not very relevant in this particular case, but for later. Let me check if I specify git log, git status, and git commit. Okay, I'm checking if there is any questions. Looks like not. You will have time later to play with that and with a bit more information. Yes, let me show two stuff here. So let me open a second file. Let me do a list first. Hello. Save file. No. Yes. So you see, I've quit, and now I have this file, hello, Jesus, a save file related to my editor, actually. And now if I'm doing git status, it will complain. It will say, of course, that I have changed hello, which makes sense, but it's also saying, oh, this file you are not tracking. And this is, of course, a file I don't want to track at all, because that's just a file created automatically by my text editor, which is basically a backup of the change I did. So in that case, what I can do is to create this file called git ignore. And put here all the files that I don't want to track. So in this case, I will take all the files that start by a hash and ending by a hash. And one thing which happens quite often with Emacs as well is file ending with tilde. So that's also things I don't want. And now if I'm doing git status, it will say that one didn't work. Maybe I need to do this. Let's test. Yes. So now you will say that, okay, it doesn't complain anymore about this hash file. So this, that's good. But of course, now I have a new untracked file, gitignore, that I can add, obviously. So I can do git add.gitignore, and I can add also hello. Commit minus n. And here we put stations for git ignore. So let me. One thing also interesting is this name Ed. So I will go back to this. So typically, Ed, I say always a name. So here the name are quite bad because okay, this is the name of the latest commit, 597 and so on, so it's very not practical. But this shortcut in some sense is Ed. So Ed is actually the place where your new commit will be attached. It's a bit more complex than that, but that's a good feeling. And what is really also interesting is that you have Ed, so it's the name of your latest commit, technically. So we can always, for instance, C3 replace that by Ed. And for the commit before that, you have the syntax Ed tilde 1. So that's the version before Ed. And that's why it's quite practical to refer to typically the last two or last three commits just by using this tilde syntax. So that's very practical in Git instead of using those quite crazy names that you can sometimes use, but those are not the things you will think about it. So if you want to have to know that name, you need to first do git log, find what the name is and use it. It's not very practical when clearly you can say, oh, that's the last commit, so a last but one commit, so it's 81 and so on. Okay. So now let's move a bit with different commands in Git. One quite useful command is git diff, and that's allow you to compare the file between your workspace and the index, or the index and the repository, or the workspace and the repository. So the three commands here is git diff, that give you the difference between your workspace and your index. And that's why knowing that the index exists is quite important, because if you have, most of the time the index will have the same file as the repository, but it's not the case. It's important to know that git diff gives you the difference between workspace and index, not the workspace and the repository. If you want that between the workspace and your latest commit, you do git diff add. If you want the commit before that, you can do, of course, git diff add tilde 1, that will be the difference with this file here. You can also specify a file, obviously, after that. And git diff minus minus cache will give you different in this file and this file. So that's where this notion of index is useful, obviously. So maybe let me give an example. Let's make remodify hello. And now do git add. I forget to say hello. Okay, now if I do git diff, I will have no difference, obviously, because they're the same file. If I do git diff minus minus cache, then yeah, I will see that I've removed all the empty line. And now if I'm modifying again my file hello, and passing this time to Damien, I'm going git diff. Now this time the file in my workspace and the file in my index are different. And that's why I see here. I can do another git add hello. And now I can do a git commit minus m. Damien. So of course my message currently, I mean, I'm doing some stupid stuff in a very stupid demonstration, obviously. So my messages are not the most clear, important for the moment. But of course, when you are doing an actual work, it's very crucial to put correct information there. There are even some people, and Damien was discussing that just before starting, some people, we have conventions on how to put a quick message here to provide information and be able to use those to create automatic documentation and so on and so on. Okay. The next comment is related to the fact, how do I move back to a previous state? So for example, I'm starting here with three colors. So this purple, I'm not sure you see the color correctly. This is red and this is blue. So in this case, all my three spaces is a different state. And if I'm going git reset head, what I'm going to do is to take the file from the latest commit from the head and move it to the index. So that's what git reset is doing. And that's allow you, of course, to reverse some change and be able to check what's going on. And from there, I can do git checkout minus minus a to move the information from the index to the workspace. The reason of this minus minus, and you will see that quite often in Git, is that sometimes we will have an ambiguity between what is information like this one, head, which is the commit that you are referring to, the commit or the branch, I will see later what branch is, and here the name of the file. So that's why sometimes you have minus minus is to say everything after this should be considered as a file. And that's why you have here minus minus. As before, there is always a way to, instead of doing two commands, to do one command. In this case, it's git checkout. You put the name of the commit, minus minus again to say after it's a file, then it's B. So that's a one way to restore a file that was removed or to go back to a given version of the file from a previous version. If I'm doing this, what I'm doing, I'm putting back the file B, both in the index and the workspace. I'm doing that for a file that was removed, but that's exactly the same if the file was not removed and was just modified. So there's also a comment which is a bit dangerous in itself, which is able to remove completely commits, actually. So you can say, oh, I make a stupid mistake in this last commit C4, and I want to completely erase that and go back to a clean state, and that's in order to, you can do git reset minus minus art and then add tilde one, so or C3 as you prefer. And in that case, the file A will be moved both in the index and the workspace, and your commit for and your fourth commit will completely disappear. So hopefully in Git you always have a way to reset from mistake. So in this case, if you realize, oh no, I want to go back to this C4, you have a command which is git reference log, and that will print you, I can do it here actually. So let me do that, git reset minus minus arg add tilde one. So I've removed one version, now I can do git ref log. And therefore, here you can see, okay, that's probably that one I have removed. And therefore, if I want to go back to it, I can do git reset minus minus arg and then copy this name or this flag, which is the same. And now if I'm doing git log, you'll see that -1 line. You'll see that this version is passing to Damien and restores. So that's the way you can restore stuff that you've completely removed in principle. That is valid for quite short amount of time. Couple of hours probably is okay, but don't expect in 1 month to be able to find it back, obviously. So in commits, we are not reachable anymore via the normal other commits. Will be pruned after time, but for a short amount of time, which may be even a week, right? I don't know exactly how long, they will be kept. So that allows you to revert to a situation when you make a mistake, but of course you need to realize that this is not full-time proof, basically. Okay? So I think it's time to make the first break. I would suggest you to try to basically redo what I've done so far, so to create a couple of commits, editing the file, find a way to revert to a previous version and so on, to play a bit with that during this 15-minute break. I will go in details first, a couple of details that was done, that need to be done. So the first thing you need to do, obviously, to first tell who you are. So typically, there is two steps, which is done by the command git config --global, then you put your username, user.name, then you put your name here, and specify your email, and you put your email there. Then, as I said, you can specify or not git ignore, that's not really needed, but it can be very useful, depending on your editor, obviously. And then you can do a git init, so that you have everything ready. Then after that, I have a couple of examples. I will put the slides online now. You can follow, but it's basically open a file. Just add on and so on. So play with that. If you have any issue, you can ask in the Q&A. I see that two questions. I will check that before going to the break and so on. So let me check the questions. I would like to know why we need the index area in the middle of the two others. So that's something, that's a good question. If you go to the last slide of my talk, there is actually a link to, I don't remember if it's a YouTube video or it's a presentations or a PDF, I don't remember, where it's a full person describing that. That's something which is actually not present in Bazaar, neither in Mercurial. So you don't really need it, to my point of view. It can help you to organize yourself. That's one of the, I would say, stupid stuff of Git. Technically, I would say you can certainly not need that part, but it's there, you can use it, or you can try to ignore it as much as possible. But the main point is that you need to be aware that it exists, because for some comments, you will see it's moving stuff back to the index, so you need to be ready and to check and to know that it's there. But I would say this is a useful know that you need to know that it's there certainly. Are the workspace index repository at offline locations? Yes. So far it's not, anything I've done is completely local to my laptop. I don't have anything on GitHub and GitLab, but that's the same if you are linking to GitHub and GitLab. You take that on your laptop, everything is on your laptop. You can decide, and we'll see that later, when you provide this information to GitHub and GitLab, but everything is local on your own computer. You can work completely offline, in the plane, in the train, or whatever you want, or decide to not synchronize yourself with the GitHub and GitLab for a year. That's no issue on that. So I hope you have the time to check a bit those comments. And now we'll move forward and continue to another topic, which I think is very important, which is the what I call workflow. So the main concept is a branch. So we'll cover that, obviously. A branch is a pointer to a commit. So that really corresponds to this idea I was describing a bit before. This is the change I'm doing for that features. So that's where I'm going to do a a development to introduce a new feature in my code, and then I will create its own branch so that you can have multiple branches corresponding to this is my stable version, this is a version where I put my debug change compared to the latest stable version, and this is where I diverge quite deeply in order to add these relatively small, relatively large features. So a branch is really not a given commit, but it can move and then it follows. When you add commits, it basically follows saying this is a concept where it contains that type of features, basically. So that's really a way to organize your work and to have different branches where you have different type of work that you are doing, different implementations that you are working on. So a branch, of course, represents not only a commit, but all the history actually to the commit. It's really a full history of development that you are keeping. And that's true in Git, not that much in Bazaar, for example. But branch is really cheap. You will see that it's instantaneous to create. It doesn't cost you basically anything. So you can take that as an opportunity to create branch very often. So each time you are saying, oh, I'm going to do that, try to avoid to do that in your main space. Always create a branch for basically everything. So branches are very, very cheap in Git. So it's create them, delete them, it's very easy, and we'll see that. So you need to do that as much as often as possible. That means basically every time. So you already actually have a branch. So if you remember here, if I'm doing git log, we'll see that, oops, sorry. You will see here that a branch is actually created. This is this green stuff, which is master. So by default, we have one branch, which is called the master. And that's where your head is pointing. The head is actually pointing typically on a branch. You see, that's where I'm going to add my new commits. It's inside that branch master. So let's go back here. So this is the representation as before, my representation of commit, commit one, commit two, commit three. And this is my representation is a circle, a blob with the name, which I call BX. It's a stupid name, obviously. And that branch is pointing to a given commit. So now if I'm doing a new commit, what I will do, I will add a fourth commit, and the branch will move together with the commit. So now my branch is going to point on the latest commit associated to that. So that's really a way to follow your development and have a convenient way to actually refer to what you are doing right now. So you can easily create a new branch. It's simply a pointer, so that's why it doesn't cost anything. And one of the ways to create a branch is git checkout minus b, and you define the name of the new branch. So in this case, restarting from here, I will have now two branches, bx and by. And here you can see a difference of representations on my slide. So there is one with this, which has a black circle around, and that's where my head is. That's where my current development is. So I'm currently focusing on BY, not on BX, which means when I'm doing a commit, only BY will be moved and BX will stay on C3. That's allow you to have different branch pointing on different stage of your development. So I already show you how to create a branch, that git checkout minus b and the name of the branch. It's very also easy to switch from one branch to the other, and that's git checkout, the name of the branch. Very easy to delete a branch, to rename a branch and move, it's a bit more advanced. So as I said, branch is very cheap, so we can do it very often. So let me do a demonstration. So here I have git log minus minus one line. I currently have only one branch master. And let's say I want to do some development. So let's do git checkout minus b. And I will call that branch dev. So now if I'm doing git log, you'll see now I have two branches, dev and master, which are both of them are pointing on the same commit, which is this one. And currently my head is pointing on dev. So now I can, for example, add a file. So let's see what I have now for the moment. Not that interesting. I can add, for example, a README. but I can add this file as you've done during the break. And now I can do a commit. Now if I'm doing git log, and here that's where graph starts to be interesting, not that much actually. So you can see here that now my head is still on dev, and dev has moved, and as when you commit, while my master is still here. Now I can, for example, move to the master, to git checkout master. I see I'm in the master. I don't see that, but it's still there. If I want to list all my branch, I can do git branch. You see, I have two branches, dev and master, and obviously on master. And here as well, I can do modifications. I will modify hello. And here, on the commit minus am. And now if I'm doing git log, fine, you see that I have also a new one. And I can ask to see both branch in my log, so I can do master and dev here. And now you see here that my two branches have what they call diverge. So each of them have the same starting point. And then now after this commit, the master has this one and the dev actually this one. So you see that they diverge. So that's why this graph here is quite interesting, so that you see that actually they are diverging. So of course the interesting thing able informations together, merge them together. That's the next part, is how to basically be able to take two versions which can be quite different and be able to merge them together. So that's what I'm going to do first here inside the presentation, and I will do inside the example. So here I have exactly the same status that I have here actually. I have two branches which have a current path, C1, C2, C3, and then they both diverge in both cases, actually, in my example, and here they diverge by one commit. It can be more than one commit, it doesn't matter. Here I have my focus on BY, so my head is on BY, like here for the moment, my head is on master. So I'm on BY, and then I'm going to type git merge, and then the name of the branch I want to merge here, BX. And what it creates automatically a new commit, and my branch BY will be pointed on this new commit, which has actually two parents, C4 and C5. So it will merge those two together, and that's what I'm going to do right now. I can do git merge. I'm in the master, so I can do git merge dev. And it automatically creates this. I'm fine with this message. And that's it. And now if I'm doing git log, you will see that those two branches diverge, and now my master contains actually the change of the two files. So when I've done that, I can either decide, let's get rid of BX, because the branch BX has no meaning anymore, so you can remove it, you can clean it, so we can do git branch minus dbx, so that with that branch disappearing, and you have clean again, and then you can create a new branch later if you need. Or what you can do is say, oh, I need to keep that branch alive. I'm checking the questions. And then I want to keep it and move it also to C6. So in that case, you can do git checkout bx. So now you have the focus here. And what I'm going to do here, so I can do git checkout. In that case, my branch is dev, so I can do git checkout dev. If I'm reprinting, you see now my head is on dev. I can also do a git merge with master. And now you see here a keyword name is called fast forward. It's just saying that Actually, it knows already how to merge them because this line already exists. So what it will do is will not create a new commit, but just move BX to this same commit here. So it will not create a new one. It will just reuse what is already existing. And that's what we call fast forward, which is a term you might hear quite often, obviously. So obviously it's not sometimes that easy, and sometimes you can have what we call conflicts. So I guess you can realize yourself that if I'm changing the same file in CA4 and C5, and not only that, if I'm changing the same line in the same file, then it's impossible for Git to know how to combine those stuff. So Git is going to do a merging line by line. So if you modify a file, a line at the beginning of the file, let's say here, and you modify in C5 the same file, but the end of the file, it will merge them and there will be no issue. We do that automatically for you. But if you modify the same line, that will not work. So let's do that here. So let's clean, let's see where we are in Git. So for now, we have two brands, dev and master. Let's keep that. I'm currently in dev. So let's modify hello again. So let's put hello dev. And then I'm going to commit that minus n. Oh, I made that on purpose, actually. You realize that it doesn't want to make my commit. Why? Because I didn't do git add. It reminds me, oh no, you don't have anything in your index. You need to put something in your index first. In this case, I will just put the A here. So if you don't, if you forget to do the git add, Git, of course, realizes that and will tell you basically that you need to do it. So now let's print again my stuff. I have a new commit inside this branch dev. So now I will do the same, check out master to move my focus branch. So when doing that, if I'm opening hello, you see that it's going back to everyone because that's the status in that branch. You see that I've automatically changed my file in my workspace. And then in this case, to make it simple, I will put hello master. Okay, let's double check, yes. And I'm going to commit again. So now if I'm looking, I have again the same difference as before. So I have two commits which is not compatible anymore, but this time I've modified the same file and the same line inside the same file. So now if I want to merge those two together, so I'm on master, so I will merge dev. It will tell me, oh, there is a conflict. So I cannot merge those two together automatically. You need to fix that. And there is a conflict, it tells me which files, in this case in the file hello. So I can open hello, so the file hello. And you will see that's typically the some information. So that is all this block, and that's what you have in your current head, so in master, and that is the current versions of the line in the branch that you try to merge in. So in this case, dev. And therefore you can decide what to do. You can keep, of course, this part or keep this part or combine them together. That's up to you. What you need to do is to remove those parts so that you basically fix the conflict. And then you decide here what you want to do or your files need to look like. And that's, of course, some things that only you are able to do. If it's a conflict with one of your colleagues, you might sometimes need to contact him to try to understand what's going on. And that's, of course, quite tedious because you need to understand a bit what's going on, why you have that conflict, and how you need to fix it, obviously. And that's, of course, impossible for Git to realize. If in this case I want to do hello master, I mean, in this case, actually, probably I want to do something like this. It doesn't matter too much for my example, but that's inside of code, sometimes you need to combine the two chains or discard of the two, depending of what's going on, obviously. So that are conflicts. And now I can do a git commit. I don't think I need to do a git add, now it bounce. And then it's finished merge branch dev. I'm okay with this message, and that's it. And now if I'm doing my stuff, you see that now I merge again and correctly. So this is what we call a conflict. And that will happen typically quite often when you have quite large change, obviously, because it's quite common that two people are going to change lines very close to each other, but in different ways, and therefore it will create those conflicts. And that I already do the demonstrations, but you need to correct your file, obviously. So obviously that's the cost in some sense to be able to work multiple people or yourself on different versions of code at the same time and complete independently. And therefore, conflict will always occur. You don't need to be afraid of them. So you don't have to try to avoid them at all costs. I typically don't care too much when I'm creating conflict. But at the same time, it's important that you stay in sync, I would say as most as possible, to try to avoid that you will have a very, very big conflict at some point, which can be quite cumbersome to fix. Because clearly, conflicts are not a great stuff. You are not very happy with 25 conflicts. That typically means there is quite a lot of work to fix them. Because each time you need to understand what is the difference between the two versions, why I did change that in that version, why you change that in that version, and how you can resolve that. So it requires each time that you really think about it. But of course, it needs to be done. So you don't have to avoid them at all costs, but also don't try to stay out of sync for 5 years and say, oh no, sync everything together, then of course we'll have a lot of conflicts. Okay, so that will happen very often and you should be used to that in some sense. So that's, you have no way to avoid them because if you have a lot of branch, a lot of people working at the same time, this will happen again, again, and again. Quite often they are simple. Also, one thing which is important here, of course, if you have a very small code, that's not a big issue, but if you have very, very large code, sometimes conflicts can break your code, obviously, if something's crazy go up and if you refactor the full code, moving a function from one file to the other and stuff like that, Git might not be able to follow all those stuff. So it's important that you have what they call unit tests, so a way to check automatically that your code is always running. So especially where you have a lot of developers which are merging all the time in all directions, having a test suite to check that everything is under control is of course important so that you know that we have no issue with those conflicts, obviously. Or even if you don't have conflict, to be sure that nothing is going to be broken. And that's, of course, something that helps you. In practice, I rarely see a conflict that was breaking the code, rarely a merge, but of course, that can happen from time to time, and it's better to prepare, obviously. This I will skip because I put it in the wrong place. So I have two nice features I want to focus on. So the first one is fixing one stupid mistake when you have those branches that you typically work in, you are working in the wrong place. So let's take this example. So I have in this case three branches, the master branch I call here M, the branch B and the branch A, and then I'm modifying this file on top of this commit. So I have a commit here, I'm starting to modify this file, and then I'm happy, I'm ready to commit. I'm doing a git log typically, or a git status, and I realize, oh, I'm in the wrong branch. So how do I move that file to the correct branch here? Because I don't want to commit it here because it makes no sense in the type of working I'm doing. So there are a way in Git to do that, and that's the command git stash, and it's git stash save info. And what it's doing, it's putting the difference that we've done inside what it's called a stash storage, and you can see all the stash that you have there with git stash list. If I'm doing that now here, we see that there's nothing. I have nothing here. Let's say I want to modify the README. Okay, I have no README in this file. So that's probably not a good idea. Let's modify hello again. Probably not a good idea either, but okay. Let's do that. Then I can do git stash. Save. Now if I'm looking at my git stash list, I'm finding, okay, write it. You see that now I have one stash, which is work in progress on master. Now I can move my branch, git checkout dev, and I can apply my stash here, and that's git stash pop. So that's what it's doing, git stash pop, then it's applying the same change to the file. So obviously here I will have a conflict. That's what's going on, obviously, because again I'm changing the same file and the same line. So now if I'm opening the file, it says, "Oh, you have done that." In this case, I will just keep this one. Yes. Now I can do a git add hello and a git commit. So that's one way. That's one way to move. I mean, if you start from a wrong branch, which I guess will happen quite often, that's one way to recover, put it in your stash, and then from your stash, move to the correct branch and reapply your change. If you have an issue because it's not completely compatible, you have a conflict that we've seen, you can typically easily fix them. If there is no issue and no conflict, then it will be done automatically. That's a very easy way. The second nice features that I want to present is what we call rebase. Let me explain what is the issue first and why. So in this case, let's start with three branches again, M, A, and B, and then you do a commit in the first, you do a commit in branch B, and those are commits which are, let's say, from two different people, they are just fixing two different bugs which are nothing to do with each other. So in this case, you see I'm modifying file A, in this case I'm modifying file B, and there is no correlations at all between the two versions. And what I want to do is to want to include both those fixes, this bug fix, inside my master branch. And typically what I simply need to do is to git merge and then the name of the two branch, and it will automatically create me a commit with those two branches, and that's it. That's very simple. But a lot of people will not like that because the history is not linear. In this case, there is no reason to have a real conflict because they a real merge because there are no real conflicts. So there's nothing wrong in itself in order to have that. But people prefer quite a lot to have an history which is a line because it's much more easy in the future when you need to look at what you did to have, okay, that's this bug fix, and then this bug fix, and then this bug fix, then adding those diamond diagrams. So in this case, a lot of people would prefer to have a single line. So in order to do that, conceptually, what we need to do is to look at the difference between one of the two branches, in this case, master and B, and then apply them after the modifications that you have done here. In this case, that's relatively easy. You just have to change the file B. Of course, doing that, and then of course you can remove the branch B, but doing that is not very clean. It's not very easy to manually change the second version, the second branch. So that's where rebase is useful because it automates that part, actually. And then you see here that the nice part, obviously, is that that is what we wanted. We have a succession of commits without any real merge at the end of the day. So that's what rebase is doing, is replaying the same change to the file starting from a different point in this case. So in practice, how does it work? So you first go to the branch A, and then you say, get rebase everything which is in the branch B. Then therefore you take the common master branch, and then we do exactly moving this difference and replaying this difference here, and then create a new commit for you. And then you can do the checkout, move your master, and remove your two branches again. And then you have this nice history. So that's basically playing with history so that we have a clean history. So the issue is that if you change the history locally, then change the history which is online on GitHub or GitLab or with your collaborators, this can create a lot of conflicts because there will have two different changing done in different way, different repository, and then that is the source of potentially a lot of conflicts. So try to do as less as possible with Rebase, and actually in Rebase there's a lot of other features. You can split a commit in two different commits. You can merge different commits into a single one. You can change your commit message. Rebase allows you to have a lot of control of the history of the repository. But keep it simple, secure, because you can destroy a lot of stuff, obviously, with that. A reflog is, of course, quite useful in this case. And try to avoid to do that, to change the history of a repository if you are sharing it or if you are taking branch from inside those stuff, obviously. I put here a link to a YouTube video where we have a lot of information on Rebase. I see there's two questions, I think. So do you always keep the master branch or is it okay to remove it? You can remove it. That's typically the convention that the master branch is the one which goes public. So that's basically the starting point that where you keep everything, but that's just a convention. But if you want to remove it, I think there is no issue on that. So if I go back to my example here, let me do the log. I'm in dev, so now I can do git branch minus d master, it will not complain. It's not fully merged, you should want to delete it. In this case, I can complaining because there is one is not merged, but in this case, it's not. So git branch minus d, and now that's it. I don't have the branch anymore. But we git branch, have that anymore. So no, master is nothing really special. It's just a convention that's the starting branch, and therefore, by default, this is where you have everything stable. But that's just a convention. You can rename that, take it as trunk or whatever if you want to use another convention. And, I see another question. So I think I'm unable to traverse the Rebase commit properly, unable to see the graph format output either. All of them seems to be linear. Okay, I'm not sure completely. I think Damien is trying to help. So in order to see those type of graph, what I do is git log. And I put in principle, I mean, here I'm having one branch for the moment. So git log, and then I typically do one line, minus minus one line. And then in order to see the graph, I need to do minus minus graph. And actually, I still see the graph, which is useful here because I have a merge here. That's what I'm doing. Now it's technically slightly depend on your version of Git. Some older version of Git, you might need to do this. Minus minus pretty equal one line. Minus minus graph, I think that's universal. Minus minus abrev commit. And sometimes also you need minus minus color. And pretty 2t, I guess. Yes. So if the just minus minus one line doesn't work, you can try this command, which might be better. For the rest, I see that Damien tell you about information how to build branch and stuff like that. Yes, it's telling you that, yeah, you cannot, of course, move the branch where you are currently on. Like this, it will not work. If I do git branch minus d dev, which is my current branch, that is not possible. Okay, so we'll take, I think it's time that we can do a second break so that you can basically play with that. So reuse the branch, the repo that we've created in the first tutorial part. Create new commits in each branch that force you to move from one branch to the other with git checkout. Then you can merge those branches. See, you can test both cases with and without commit as I did, and then play if you want with the rebase method or with the stash method, and we'll restart also in 15 minutes, so at 15:45. So maybe I will just do a demo for the rebase method and a couple of comments. A typical mistake that coming when you are in face to face, and you ask me this year, then the feedback, so I will take the opportunity to do it now. So let's do a rebase. So let's first look at the status now. Okay, yeah, that's a good point. So I will recreate a second branch. I will recall it master, so that I branch master, it doesn't matter too much. And then what I will do, I will do a rebase. So let's check what I have inside. I have two files, readme and hello. So a good example for readme, for a rebase, is that in one branch, I'm going to change the readme, in the other branch, I will change the hello. So currently I'm in the master branch, so I'm going to change the readme in this case. Do something beautiful. Okay, so I'm going to commit that. So minus A to add in the index, and then minus M to directly put the message. Me. So if you look here, you see that in my master, I have one more revisions commit compared to the dev branch. Now I'm going to inside the dev branch. So I'm going to check out that branch, dev. And in this case, I'm going to change the file hello. And I will go back again to the world. And then do a commit. So if I'm looking at git log, I'm looking at the two branch, master and dev, minus minus one line, minus minus graph. You will see again that I have some diagonals here, but I don't want to merge them exactly like I have them here. I want to go back to a clean history when I have one change after the other, because I know in this case that there is no conflict at all. There is no reason to have a real merge. Those could have been done in a successive way. So in this case, what I would do, so on which branch I am, I'm on dev, so I'm git rebase master, and if I'm looking at the history now, you will see now that I have now a clean history. There is no divergence anymore. That was an example of rebase. Now I can do git checkout master and do git merge dev. That's a fast forward, and now if I'm looking again, you see that they are both here, and now there is no. I mean, it looks like that I never had to do a rebase, I never had to do a merge because it's a clean history. So when I'm coming back later, looking at this, everything is quite clean, and I will not have a conflict. I will not have this divergence, which is always a bit annoying to handle in terms of history. To know, okay, if I have a bug between this and this, is it that one or is it that one? Does it matter that much? Here, everything is clean and. A lot of people put a lot of interest in those history. I don't that much, but it's interesting, of course, with clean history that's actually help you later on. So another mistake that is typically occurring is that people do this. So we have a lot of revisions here, and then sometimes people do git checkout. And checkout, if you remember at the beginning, it's also allowed to move files from the repository to your workspace. But instead of asking for a file, they ask for a full revision. So typically, let's say, let's go back quite in time, they do this. And then in this case, if you do that, we'll change all your file to this version. So that's a bit what you expect. But then Git will complain about something called dethead. They say, oh, I'm not sure where to write anymore what you want. And then typically the solutions in that case is to create a new branch from here. So you do the git branch minus b and then whatever name, let's say feature one. Git checkout. And now it's not complete anymore. And then I'm doing git log. Git log. Well, let's do minus minus one line. I'm just back exactly at that state. It's AP, the head now is linked to a branch and there's no problem anymore. So that's, I guess a couple of you have tested the first exercise phase, this headless state. It's typically because you move back quite a lot with a simple checkout. In that case, recreate a branch at that stage. It's typically what you want to do, and you can move forward from that. Let's check out back the master. Okay. So there's no additional question. So let's move forward. So let me recap what we have seen so far. So we mainly work alone on our laptop. What we are going to do now is to be able to collaborate with other people and go online. So for the one we are able to play with one history to do commits and add those commits, re-verify to previous state, go back to create new branch and play with different branch locally so that we can have multiple working different stuff at the same time. Now we want to do that, but not alone, but online. So there are various platforms that basically allow you to share your work online. And of course, the most famous one is GitHub and GitLab. And also each university provides its own GitLab platform. So you have one in Namur, you have one also in Louvain. In Louvain is called The Forge. In Namur, I think it's just called GitLab. Let me go to internet. See here, Namur is very simple to find. This is gitlab.inamur. Internet seems very slow. All people from Inamur, of course, have an account. I do as well. And Louvain is called The Forge. So it's forge.uclouvain.be. It also asks you to sign here with your UCL account, obviously. And then you will have access, you can create your repository there and so on. So here we will actually, for these presentations, so that it's also generic for everyone, we use GitHub, but that's basically the same concept all the time. So let me go to GitHub. So I just go to GitHub. Here you see a couple of directories that I'm sharing with different people. You will see that I'm connected here. So if you are not connected, you can create an account. That's very easy, obviously. You can see some recent activity I have done, some activity of other people. We have forked my stuff or look at my code or whatever. So you have a lot of information. So here we go inside a repo that I've created for these lectures. So you'll see here, you will see here all the files. You see here the list of the files. When they were changed last time, so the README I changed 7 hours ago, suddenly 3 days ago, and it's giving now basically years ago. They can actually edit them online. So what I'm doing here, I can even click online and change it. Let's say remove this. And if you go below, you have information is commit, update README, I can modify that, I can modify error informations. Update, and I can decide to commit directly to the master branch, so just add a git commit normal, or create a new branch and doing a pull request. So that's what I'm going to do. A pull request is allow you basically to ask someone else, basically if you don't have the right, or if you're more than one people working, you can say, I've done this, I plan to move that in the master, and then some people can comment on it, so I will do that. It creates automatically, in this case, a branch for me. You can see here I have a pull request now. Actually, I have two. No, I didn't push it. I didn't make the pull request, did I? And I can create the pull request. Yeah. I thought it was creating both. I should check the button I click. And now you have here the pull request. I have a place where I can comment. And that's really nice. Also those, I mean, for me, GitHub is quite complex. And I prefer, as I said, a Bazaar, which is much more simple in terms of how much comment you have. And it's less prone to error because each comment is much more clear, where in GitHub, it's a bit of a mess. What is really the advantages of Git and why Git is so popular at the end of the day is really those websites. Because those websites are really well done and allow you to really collaborate and play and discuss with other collaborators. So it's more than a Git repo that you, as you've done so far on your laptop, it's really a place where you can collaborate, so you can discuss. So if you make a pull request, if another collaborator makes a pull request, then you can discuss it, I don't like that. Say, I don't like your change, could you do this? So you can rediscuss and even conversations about the code before putting it in production, before putting in the master, before creating a release for the user, and so on and so on. So that's really a place where you can discuss development. You can make also merge requests in for work in progress, saying, I don't want to merge this now, but we can discuss. And then you can, in principle, also go line by line, I guess here, and inside the file, put some comments directly there as well. So that's really a nice way, which is even more useful than Git itself. That's really now a platform where you can actually collaborate with different people. Then you can comment. Let me comment here. It's a stupid comment, but whatever. And I can do also the merge. And I confirm the merging. And now this will be merged inside my master. So that's a nice way. You can also have pull requests from other people. So if I'm going back to pull requests here, so that it's by someone called Bill Moruve, actually. So I can look here, click on it. And it's adding, it's modifying, looks like, if I'm going here. So actually, in this case, it's conflict. So we can look at that, try to fix, try to resolve the conflicts, and so on and so on. But that's a place where now that someone asked me something, I can really discuss, say, if I want to add that change or you don't want to add that change, and so on and so on. So now that's that real platform where you can collaborate with people. Going back here. So in terms of having pull requests where we have really other people other than you that can collaborate, you have also a place for questions or remarks, what it's called issues in Git. It's really a place where you can ask questions. So let me ask put a new issue that can be for yourself, right? But that also be for people from outside. So I can put it an example to do. Add one more. Add something, I don't know. Teacher here. would be great because so you can explain an ID, for example. And you can also assign someone. So I think Damien was at some point linked. No, it looks like not, it's not yet available. But to differ, no, okay. But you can, if you have a collaborator, you can put this login here, then you say, oh, I would like you to do that if possible. What do you think about that ID? That again, you can discuss. Simply, you can submit the issue. You can have tags, obviously, and all those kind of stuff. That's really a place where it's on top of Git, really, that you use on your laptop. That's a place where you can collaborate. You can do a lot of stuff online. You don't need even to put the file on your laptop. But that's a place where you can collaborate here. So typically, how you get this code on your laptop, you have the code here, then you have the address. Now I'm opening my terminal, going one directory above, just checking that it's not, let me remove this directory. Now I can do git clone, and then the link, and now I'm going to clone and have all the file, all the branch, which are online, I will have here. So if I'm going in the directory, you'll see that I have the same two files that the one I have online. Actually, I have three online, but that's just because one is hidden. So I also have this git in there, so that's an issue. And now I'm in git, so I can do git log. Right, let me use git branch to check the branch. I only have a master branch here. And do git log. Do -- one line. Then you see all the different branches. You see that I have multiple, only one here branch, but I have other type of branch that I will discuss later. So that's the way I get the information. I can modify a file again. Let's call let's fill this, for example. Let's add Frederic. So now I can do commit -an to add automatically. And it's a message. Change line. So I can check back again my history, so you see that I add one more. In that case, since I'm master, I can push that information online. I do git push, and of course, now everything is online. I can go back here, refresh maybe. You see that it has in the chain this file 29 seconds ago. That's one way. So git push allows you to publish all your information online. In this case, of course, I mean, a workflow when I am, in this case, I guess a single author of this, so I can check that here. If I go manage access. That's a good question. Yes, then it tells me who has access is currently and the only one who can access this. So you have typically two types of workflow. Two types of collaborations with different people. So the first collaboration is a quite natural one, is that everyone has access to the GitHub repository online. So that's the case where you know the people we are working with. So that's typically you are relatively close collaborations, and then you are all working together, you know yourself, and then you put everyone access to one public repo. And in that case, you basically take the information, that's git fetch to get additional information that's coming from the repo, and then you push them, and then everyone is doing that. So everyone is synchronizing themselves on the public repo on the same one, and that's very easy. Everyone has read and write access there, so everyone can do that and synchronize themselves. They can do push requests or not, depending on your workflow that you choose to take. Typically, I mean, what I'm doing, that in the master, you always do a push request so that everyone is aware as soon as the master branch changes. But for the features and debug branch, typically you don't do pull requests. That's my way to work with my collaborators. But of course, each collaboration can define how to do that. So that's the first workflow that you can do with Git or GitHub or any website. Is everyone can write, and then typically you organize yourself when you use push requests and when you simply push it directly there. The second workflow is typically when you actually you don't even know some people. So you have your local repository, so you have your versions on your laptop, and and you push it online on your public repo, and then someone is going to take it. Someone you have no clue who it is, it's working on the other side of the world, you never know his name, but you find your project interesting, and he cloned it on his local computer. And then it's modifying, that means creating new revisions, adding new features inside your code, fixing a bug, or for whatever reason it takes your code, right? And then it doesn't have access to your public repository. So typically what it's going to do is going to create its own public repository on GitHub and GitLab, which contains your content, but also all the stuff that it adds. And therefore, then it can create now a merge request inside your repo saying, oh, I've done that. If you're interested, you can use it. Or you can even find it yourself or after discussions. And then yourself inside your repository, make a fetch of that one, take the information. When you have everything locally, you can merge and then push back. So that's a way also to collaborate. So let me give an example here. I will try at least. So let me share. Let me change computer. Let me check if it works. I think it should work. Yes. So let me go and GitHub as well here. So you can see here I have a different icon. So now I'm actually on the different computer. And actually, what I did in this computer, I have the same information. I have the same repo what I actually have plugged. So I've done that before. So what I did. So let me go back here. You see here I have polymathematic lectures, and what I did, I cloned it. In this case, I can't fork it anymore because I haven't done it in the past, but that's the basic idea. You can take from GitHub and GitLab, you say fork, and that's creating your own public repo, which has the information, but now we have wide access there, so you can really modify everything which is inside. And therefore, that's what I have done before, actually. You can take a file from the, you see that I have here, Olivier Matelard and Damien François. I can probably merge that with the latest version. So let's do a merge. I need to create a pull request first, I guess. New pull request. So let's take from the Git lecture, the master, and now from the next event. I'm feeling confused. Let's go here. Let's make a merge request. Here I want to merge here, and I want to merge. That doesn't like that. And then why doesn't want me to merge those two? Yeah, it looks like I need to do it on my laptop then. Whatever. But then I can merge different versions, update the file, and go back and ask the pull request. So in this case, this version is not exactly the same. I've done some change already, and that's why actually from this account that I created a merge request before, and then I can collaborate like that. I can also see here, so actually here, so I'm on this laptop. I have actually done, I can do git log, so you see a couple of stuff. You can do a git fetch that will download all the information. And what I want to do now is also take the information I take from the other public repo, because this takes from the public repo of the account Bimoru. I want to take that from the account Olivier Matala. So let's do that. And let's see here the forking. Okay, so now I have taken all the information from the official repo again, so I have all the information here. And now I can push that information online. Now I'm doing a git log. And see all the information here. So let me explain now what those origin XXX are. So let me move back to the other computer. So what's going on when you do a clone or a fetch? You take the information on the server, let's say a clone first, and that's going to replicate everything on your machine. And now instead of, in top of having a master branch like on the server, you see that there is a new branch created, which is named origin slash master. So origin is just a name for saying this branch is a bit special. It's a remote branch. So that's a branch that you cannot modify because it's just saying what is the status on the cluster from the last time you know what the status on the cluster was. So now assuming that someone else is updating the cluster, so you make a, it's changing, you make a push on the cluster, so now you will have additional commits. Those will not arrive automatically inside your local machine because you need to have a communication. You need to say, take those informations. And that's what the fetch is doing. So take the additional information, check the status on the server. And what's going on when you do a fetch? It will add this new commit, but not in your master branch, only inside the master. So it's actually two branches work exactly like two branches, except in principle, I mean, more than in principle, you cannot work in origin slash master. You can only work in your local branch, so like master. And now that you have two branches, you can decide to merge master and do git merge. And in this case, it will be a fast forward. So what a remote branch are, those are kind of normal branch, except that they represent a branch on a remote repository. So a repository that you don't control actively, that is not in sync, and therefore those information can change, and you know that they can change. So there are a local pointer, and that still reflects what you currently know about the state of master on that cluster. So it will change over time. Each time you do a fetch, basically, all those information will change. So that's how to get information is get fetch, then you take all the information on the cluster and move it locally. So and doing git log minus one line, you will see that they have different origins. So in this case, origin is always GitHub, and they have multiple branch on GitHub. When it's called Olivier patch one, when it's origin/Damien, there's a branch Damien online, and master in this case origin/Ed, but currently I have one local master. I don't have any local Damien, for example. So those are, now you understand what those are, that really branch on the cluster that I can basically copy, modify from there, and so on and so on. So if I'm going online, looking online, you will see actually the same. I'm going to code here. And I'm looking here, I have all the branches. You see also that I have Damien and Olivier patch one, exactly like you see here. Sorry, yeah. You see that I have origin master, origin head, those three are completely synchronized. And I have origin Damien, which is a quite old branch looks like. Okay. So to send information, when you have updated, I will show you that actually, is push. So that will take your commits and move them online, but that will only work if there is no real merge, if only fast forward is possible. So if you have, if someone else has push information before you and you cannot do a fast forward, then it will fail. And what it will ask is, do the merge locally, so you need first to get the information, hit fetch, merge with the latest information, or do a rebase as you want, and then you can recommit if needed. So if you have conflicts, you need a commit. If there's no conflict, there's no need of commit. So that's exactly the same as locally with two local branch, right? So when you have two local branch, you can sometimes have conflict. It's the same issue, except that you are going online, but that doesn't change anything on the commit. If you, two people are creating the same file, inside the same file, the same line, then you will have a conflict and you will need to fix them. But that's exactly the same. So this is a summary of most of the useful comments. So you have checkout, that's for taking information from a branch or a commit and put it in the workspace. Add takes the files in the workspace and move them in the index. Commit takes the file in the index and put in the repository. Commit minus A takes from here. Oops, sorry. Commit minus A takes directly from the workspace, moving inside the index and the repository directly. And then you have comments which is related to the remote repository. Git clone to create everything the first time. Then to update the information is git fetch. After that, you can do the merge. And you can actually also do directly git pull. That will do the fetch and directly merging these informations. And then git push is taking your data and move them on the remote repository. So with that slide, actually, you have a quite nice summary of all the stuff you can do. So obviously, in order to be able to do git push, you need to be identified, and therefore you need a key. So if you go, let me do it. If you go on top, here you have your login. And then you go to settings, and you will have, here, SSH and GPG key. And therefore here you can add SSH key, and that will allow you to, of course, identified. So you are used to SSH key because of the CC, because we use SSH key as well. I don't recommend that you use the same, obviously, simply because the CC key change every year and that's you have a passphrase on it. So I typically advise you to put a key which doesn't have a passphrase that you need to generate yourself. If you don't remember how to do that, you do SSH keygen, and then it will generate a key. It will ask you where you want to put it. You typically put OK. In this case, I will cancel it because I don't want to do it. And then it will create your key. It will ask you the passphrase. For this kind of stuff, you typically don't put passphrase, and then you move the public key online. And that's what I've done actually before, and that's what allowed me to do those git clone with those special protocol and Git push, and that's allow me to each time check this private key, and therefore I have access thanks to that. So that's a very convenient, and that's of course a very common in all those repository or online informations. You did the same actually for Singularity a couple of weeks ago. Okay. Yeah, one thing which is also, I didn't tell you how to start a Git project on GitHub. It's very simple actually. You can, you have a button new, you create. And one thing which is very nice with Git and especially GitHub is that you will always have help online. So let me create a new directory as well. Let me go back here. Okay. Actually, I have a button here, tell people place where this button is. I'm going to create a new one. Let's put it private, this one, and then I can add automatically a couple of files. I don't care about the license. I need to include the license. Like that one. Then I can create the repository. So it's as simple as that. And then to clone it, you have the information here. Sometimes you'll even more information. If you create it empty, it will also, let me do that actually, let's create another one empty. Free, public, and let's create it completely empty. You will see it will tell you information, so how to from your laptop move your information by adding comments and stuff like that. So that's very practical. You see this in particular, that's how to link your repo to this. So that's very convenient information here, how you can start and how you can link what you've done on your laptop, how to link that online. Okay. That's what I tell you. Adding collaborators, I've shown you the button already. I mean, online you have a lot of convenient way to look at the code. One thing I like in particular, so if I'm looking at the code, let me go back here. Let me choose another repo. Let me go to this one, yes, for example. Oh no, I probably this one would be probably better. That's a real project. Let's go here, let's go to one file. Go here maybe. Let me just try to find a file. And then you see a button that I like a lot, which is blame. And therefore you see here the people would modify for the last time the line. You see the commit message associated to that given line. In this case, that's a lot of Stefan did. I guess at some point we'll have some line on my line as well. But then you see basically who changed that line, when, and for which reasons. So that's very useful to learn a bit, okay, what's going on in this file, and then for you can see who changed what, and that's very useful a lot of time for debugging and for see stuff. That's, of course, a comment that also exists on the terminal, but typically something that I do online because it's much more practical with a real graphical display in this case, rather than a terminal. Okay. So I don't see the questions anymore. Let me see if there's questions. So is it necessary, is it two questions, right? So I, is it two or three? So I would like to know what the difference between fetch and pull. Can we use git pull after git load? So yes, so that's, I guess you were asking before I put this slide. So the fetch is not changing your workspace at all. It's really only taking more information. So you will see that we have new branches online, and then you can decide what to do with them. When you do a merge, that means git pull is doing the fetch plus the merge for you. So that's a kind of a shortcut, git pull, but in practice you can do in two steps if you want. So that's of course the also complexity of Git, that you always have different commands to do the same stuff. Either you have a series of commands or you have a single one, and sometimes you use one, sometimes you use the other, and that's what I found a bit sometimes complicated on Git, that you have all those commands, and then you have those commands with combinations of two, and then all of them with combination of three, and so on and so on. So yes, is it necessary to push explicitly to the origin? By default, it should be, I mean, you have a default which is set up for the origin. So typically, you just do git push, and it's going to push on the origin. If you have multiple origins, so if you have multiple online repositories that you share information because you have different collaborators, or you don't all have access on the same place, then sometimes you need to specify which one you push, but there is always a default, obviously, as Damien was mentioning on the chat. Okay, so this brings me to my conclusions. So what I think is crucial to, I mean, as a very crucial conclusion, is that its versioning is, I think, very, very important for both small and large projects. So I would advise you to use versioning as much as possible, basically for everything. Even if you are not going online, if you are doing a small project, versioning is really key for yourself, because it's always nice to go back in time. I know that, I mean, of course, on Mac we have kind of versioning for free, but you don't have the key information about the name and have the structure of history, having all those one after the other commits, which is quite important. I mean, if you take on Mac, for example, what is Time Machine, which is allow you to go back in time, the only information you have is the date. And that's, of course, practical if you just remove a file and you want to get it back, that's very useful. But in order to be able to compare on a long time period and be able to go back and be able really to find a bug and stuff like that, it's, of course, not enough. I would say avoid Dropbox as much as possible. This is not a place for collaborations. Dropbox is really a place if you want to share file, I would say for a small amount of time. It's not a place where you can elaborate a code with the collaborations. That's certainly something you should avoid as much as possible. If someone tells you, oh, we are going to put our code on Dropbox, please take that code, moving on Git and say, okay, now we have a Git repository and you can all have access there. And then you can refer to any tutorial or to my lectures, because it's really important that we have something much more powerful and much more safe and much more useful than Dropbox for sharing content, especially for code. I say it multiple times, it's really important to have what I say meaningful commits, so that when you commit, you also always say why you are doing that commit. Of course, in all my demonstrations, I mean, my commit message was not that useful, because also my example was not that useful. But okay, that's I think something really important to always git commit minus m and then put here a message. I fixed that bug, put a reference online link on the bug and stuff like that. I did that, I add these new features. The more information you put is really important. Of course, don't say I modify that file because that is anyway part of the automatic part of the commit. You know, when you do a commit, all the file change or the line change. So it's useless to say back what it is, but say I add this feature, this new style of stuff, obviously. So as I said, I'm not the biggest fan of Git, to be honest. I find it a bit complicated, a bit too much complicated, especially because like those three areas, I would say the index is not very necessary to my point of view, but it's really important those days to be able to use it because it's the standard. So, and since it's so much a standard, so now I would say you need to go to that one and that's it. It's pointless to learn today Bazaar, even if it's much better. It's pointless to use Mercurial, which is also very good, and certainly not a good time to learn SVN or even all the coding systems. So Git is really the must go for the moment, even if it's a bit more complex. People went to Git, I think mainly because of GitHub, it was so powerful. However, Git is not the most powerful. I mean, it's quite complex. We are actually more than 100 comments, if I'm correct. You are not going to use most of them, but okay. So if you need more information, to answer one of those questions, so you have this link here. Why do we need an index? You have here a web page trying to explain that. I would not say I'm fully convinced, but at least there are some information. If you want to know a bit more on the technical part on Git, especially on the storage structure and stuff like that, we have this nice YouTube video. I don't remember what I put, what was this documentation, but I think it was quite well done. I should have checked it actually. So thanks a lot. Don't hesitate to play, and we'll stay on the chat for, I don't know how long, but we'll stay a couple of time. If you have any issue, don't hesitate to ask. If you want to know more about a topic, don't hesitate to ask as well. Otherwise, please fill the survey. Tell me if it was useful, if it was clear, what I can improve. All feedback is always more than welcome, especially because I don't see you, I don't have any very direct feedback. So if you can fill the survey, it would be really great. Thanks a lot.